Welcome to Pure Experiences. This is the series on reading and commentary on Shiva Sutra. The next verses are about the states of the consciousness. Gyanam Jagrata. Knowledge is waking. And the other book says the external organic knowledge constitutes the waking state. This should be obvious. The knowledge of the illusion as well as the knowledge of the self is possible only in the waking state. Swapno Vikalpa. Dreaming is imaginations. Our internal perceptions and thoughts compose the dreaming state. Whenever this word kalp comes, it means imagination. Aviveko Maya Sushuptam. Non-distinction is deep sleep, which is Maya. This one says forgetfulness and negation of awareness is the dreamless state or Maya. And my comment here is that Aviveko Maya may mean that there is a complete absence of what is illusion and what is not in the deep sleep state. Deep sleep is Maya, but then the dreaming and waking is also Maya. So I think it makes no sense to call only the deep sleep as Maya. Therefore, a better interpretation will be that there is a lack of judgment about what is Maya in the deep sleep. Tritraya Bhokta Viresh. The eater of the triad is Shiva, or the enjoyer of the triad is Shiva. And this book says the one who enjoys in the oneness of awareness all of the three states, waking, dreaming and deep sleep, becomes the master of all organic energies. So Viresh here means the lord of the brave, and that is another name for Shiv, another name for consciousness, or is a title for a yogi who has mastered all the states. So Bhokta means the experiencer. I think it should not be called the eater or the enjoyer. These words are not that accurate. Experiencer of the three states is the one who has conquered his own mind. He is the one who is Viresh. If there is no awareness in all the states, that means the Matrika Shakti has full control over this organism. The Shakti is running the show, not the experiencer. Vismayo Yog Bhumika. The stages of yoga are a wonder. And this book says the predominant sign of such a yogi is joy-filled amazement. So Vismaya here means amazement, a wonder. Everybody knows the yoga. Bhumika can be interpreted in many ways. So here they have interpreted it that as predominant sign. Here it is interpreted as the stages. But I think it should be the ground, just like this alternate meaning shows. Bhumi also means ground. So those who are in the union, those who are in the yoga, their ground state is that of blissful amazement, wonderful state. In other words, they are always in bliss. So here is some commentary that what kind of amazement is this? This yogi, upon entering into that limitless state of bliss, Anand, is never satiated with the experience. On the contrary, he feels bathed with the amazement of joy. This is the predominant state of yoga, of yogi who has become one with the Supreme Lord, the Supreme Tattva, Shiva Tattva. And by this, you can surmise that he has ascended to the state of Shiva. On the other hand, to perceive at the place of rectum, Muladhar, a joyful state of consciousness, or to perceive effulgent light between the two eyebrows are not the states of such a yogi. These are to be discarded. There is only one sign of such a yogi, and that is that he is filled with amazement, overflowing with joy. So this must be everyone's experience, that a sensation here or the sensation there or the light shining here or there is all illusion. It is not joy. The real wonder is knowing what you are. The real wonder is, the real bliss is knowing your true essence and abiding there. This is the most blissful state that is possible for any living thing. So I agree with this number 12 here. Ichha Shakti Ruma Kumari. Desire, power is Uma, the virgin. Now here we are entering the typical Shaiv philosophy of Shakti, the Shakti part, who is given so many names. Actually, there must be hundreds of names that are given to the Shakti, and there are hundreds of images that are made. of this goddess. So one of the name here is the Uma. Another name is Kumari, which means the virgin. Uma means the one who resides in the heart. So this verse is actually saying that the Shakti is manifested as a desire. A desire or an intention is the seed for an action, always. Whether the action happens in nature, it is an intention of the nature. Whether that action happens through a living thing, it is the intention of that living thing. And actually, these intentions are of nobody except of the Uma. The intention is born in the heart of the Shakti. This book says, his will is the energy of Lord Shiva and it is called Uma and it is called Kumari. Or, for such a yogi, his will is one with the energy of Lord Shiva. Unobstructable, completely independent, always given to play. So, that adds a lot to the simple one-line sutra here, which is simple to understand. And why it is called Kumari, why it is called virgin. The text here is saying that the Sanskrit word Kumari can be translated and understood in a number of ways. It could be that Kumari refers to that energy that plays in the universe, creating, protecting and destroying it. And then he goes on to say why the word was used, which is not very important here. There are stories of why this energy should be called Kumari or any other thing. My interpretation of the word, the virgin, is that the energy produces without any other agency. There is no other thing involved when the creation happens through the Shakti. It is a virgin birth always. Whenever something is created, it is created simply by the desiring power of the Shakti. And she remains as virgin as before. So we may say that sometimes that the Shakti is married to the Shiv, but Shiv plays no role at all in the creation. The Shakti is solely responsible for the creation. She is the mother, but what kind of mother? A virgin mother. She does not need any help from anybody, not even Shiv, to create. And those who are coming from the Advaita tradition will completely agree here. Because what do we say in the Advaita is that the Maya or the illusion or the appearances are non-causal, which is a straightforward way of saying things, not like this, desire, power, Uma, virgin. Nobody really understands these things. It is very easy to simply say that the consciousness does not cause the experience. The experience is virgin always. So those who are wondering why, you should go and listen to the Manduk Karika, which I read recently. We never see a causal link between the Shiva and Shakti. The experience and the experiencer are not causally related. Why is that? Because they are one. It takes two to form a relation. If it is one, then no causation can be said to be there because it is meaningless. One thing can create other, but one thing cannot create itself. Therefore, in Advaita, we say that nothing gets created. It simply appears to be there. The appearance is said to be coming from a desire. It is a concept. There is nobody there who is desiring. Shakti is not a woman who is desiring. It is just all metaphors. So this is very typical of Shaiv tradition now. Everything will be dressed in very long-winded metaphors. It takes a lifetime to go into the bottom of these metaphors. Simply, you can read that the creation is non-causal. If you read this verse here, drishyam shariram, and it is translated, any visible object is a body. And the other book says something completely different. This entire perceived world is his own self. Or his own body is just like an object to him. So we already have three interpretations here. You can pick anything you want. My interpretation would be that the body is an experience. The body is not me. The body is not the experiencer. That can be another interpretation. But if you connect it with the Uma above, you can say that whatever is visible is the body of the Uma. The mother is visible as this universe. So this interpretation is coming close to my understanding. Any visible object is a body. Body of the Shakti. The Shakti itself is appearing as many objects. But I don't think this interpretation had that intention to say. And this is completely different. It is being said from the point of view of the yogi. So you can pick anything. I don't find any error in these sentences, but whether they represent the sutra is a matter of debate now. It's 15. Hrude chitta sangatan drishya swapna darshanam. So I think a whole paragraph has been condensed into one word here, and it is translated as, from the union of the mind in the heart is the appearance of dreams of any visible object. Which, as you can notice, is completely nonsensical for an ordinary person. And this book says, when his thoughts are diverted to the center of God consciousness, then he feels the existence of God consciousness in oneness, in the objective world and in the world of negation. So everybody knows Hriday is the heart. Chit is the mind. Sangatat can be interpreted to mean the union or junction. Drishya is the that whatever is visible. Swap has been translated as the dream. Darshanam is seeing, seen. So my training says that when the mental activity is seen from the point of view of the heart, which is the self, whatever is visible is seen as a dream. That is what I would say if you show me this line here without reading the other lines, other interpretations. That is what I would say it means after going through the meanings of the words here. So this is very close actually. From the union of the mind in the heart is the appearance of dreams of any visible object. So, but I don't understand anything in this. This is also very close that when the thoughts are diverted to the center, then everything is seen as consciousness. And this is, the swap has been translated as the world of negation. So he makes it clear that here the word heart does not mean our own physical heart. Rather, here the word heart means the light of consciousness. So yes, many people use heart as the center of the self, not the organ heart. So some people, when they instruct the student to concentrate on the heart, many take it literally and they concentrate on the chest. They keep concentrating on the chest till the heartbeat becomes so obvious and takes the whole of the attention that it gives rise to some kind of mystical experience flying or something. I mean, that is a complete misinterpretation. Focusing on the heart is to abide in the self. So I'm trying to find something, some more pointers here. This is said in Vijnana Bhairav. O Parvati, the one who with one-pointedness directs all his organs including his mind in the voidness of that heart, which is the light of consciousness and remains in between the two lotuses of thisness and I-ness, becomes glorified with God consciousness. So this is so true, isn't it? This is very, very true. So here the Shiva is telling Parvati, his wife, that this method or this is a kind of samadhi to remain in between the experience of what is happening and the experiencer that is here witnessing. If you stay in between, you will observe a dynamic consciousness without labels and without forms or any kind of knowledge. No names, no forms. There is just experiencing. This is the in-between state. And that is your meeting with the pure consciousness, which is both the happening and the witnessing at the same time. And here everything looks like dream. Here you don't want to even analyze what is going on. Here the attention is not in the heart and not in the sensory data. It is in between. And now you can see that whatever appears is like dream. It is dreamlike. So only this word is a problem here. We do not know what to do with the heart and the mind here. But like this book says, it is direction of your attention into the heart. Heart means the place where the self is, your innermost center, which is seen as the witnessing center, which is not seen as any experience. So direct your mind to that place, and now you will be established in samadhi. If you do not lose the awareness, it will be like just like savikalp samadhi. So it is, they are called two lotuses of thisness and I-ness. So as usual, everything has a symbol, a sign somewhere. This is the typical thing about Shaivism. It's too much symbolism here. Sometimes I feel that is counterproductive, because this marvelous teaching gets lost in the lotuses and the Uma and the virgins and things like that. And probably it was done to keep the knowledge secret, to protect it from people who were against it. Because if this kind of knowledge comes out in the public, nobody gets to rule them. The rulers are seen as animals who are trying to dominate people. And so the ruling class killed anybody who talked of freedom or liberation or knowledge or evolution of the mind and so on. So this is not new. This is happening since thousands of years. And then the great sages, they made an attempt to symbolically transfer the knowledge. Sometimes I think the Shaiv philosophy is much older than Advaita. You can see the symbolism even in the Sumeria, or even older than that. The tridents and the bulls and the flying bulls and all these phallic symbols. You will see that they predate the Vedic culture. Anyway, that is my opinion. I don't claim to know. I cannot provide you any evidence. But the Shaivic tradition was so strong and so popular that its spread was from the modern day Caspian Sea to the modern day Vietnam. Whole of the Asia was Shaiv. And that was very long ago. It is not a recent thing. You will find images of Pashupatinath and yogis in the Indus Valley civilization also. So there is a relation between Vedanta and Shaivism, but I don't have any clue what is the relation. They seem to be separated by time. Shuddha Tattva Sandhana Dwap Pashu Shakti, which is translated as from the union with the pure principle without the power of animals. How to have the union without the power of animals? I'm just joking. I mean, there must be some meaning here. This book says, or by aiming at the pure element of Shiv, he possesses Shiva's unlimited energy. So completely different interpretation. So let's try to break it up a little bit. Shuddha pure, Tattva is element, Sandhana is union, joining, or creation, Va is or, Pashu is animal, Shakti is energy. What can you make up of this thing? So I have no clue actually. I'll go by this interpretation, which I find is more meaningful. It is possible to harness this energy by abiding as pure consciousness. You can say it is my energy now, because you can see it as myself. So this says that in the sutra, the pure element refers only to Supreme Shiv. That is right. You must see that this universe is residing in that pure element. There you'll never find any impure object. Everything will appear to you as divine. That is true. The yogic powers, which are attained with the perfection of an initiation from a great master, when compared with the supreme universal consciousness, are not equal to its 16th part. These yogic powers are nothing in comparison. They are all to be discarded. You have only to own and maintain this universe, this universal I. That is called samadhan. The Sanskrit word samadhan means aiming. The Vijnan Mara also speaks in the same way. With one-pointed attention, you must feel and perceive that this universe and your body are simultaneously one with God consciousness. And then the rise of that supreme God consciousness takes place. And this is also explained in the Spandakarika. For such a yogi who has this kind of perception, this world is a playground, always filled with joy. He is never sad. Doubtlessly, he is liberated while living. Jivan Mukta. So everything is clear except the word Pashu here, which I would say is there to remind us that every other power that people are after are due to their animal tendencies. Every other power is inferior to becoming Shiva. So he is, when he says without the power of animals, probably he wanted to say that the yogis who are after powers are just executing their animal tendencies. The union with the pure principle is the real power that you can have. Everything looks like a play, then you don't want to even change it or do anything or to have anything in it, because it is all you, it is all being done by you as pure consciousness. You are the player, you are the director, you are the producer, and you are the audience. This is amazing. You don't need to meddle into what is happening or to channel your animal lower tendencies into the Shakti, who is perfect, who is the most beautiful thing that is happening. Why would you make it ugly by interfering in what is happening? Why make it dirty? It is very pure. Vitark Atmagyanam. Reflection is knowledge of the self. Other meaning, any inference of such a yogi is knowledge of his own real self. So vitark can have many meanings, as it is mentioned here. Reflection, conjecture, imagination, supposition, guess, opinion. And here the word reflection is used, which is, I think, okay. Here the word inference is used. No problem. I don't see a problem there. So such a reflection on the self constitutes the self-knowledge. It is very easy. Look at that which is experiencing. Keep the experiences aside. That which is experiencing is me, is the Atma, is the I, is the self. It takes 2 minutes. Lokanand Samadhi Sukham. Pure happiness of the world is a joy of contemplation. The joy of his Samadhi is bliss for the whole universe. And I would say it may mean that all the bliss of this universe is equal to the bliss of the Samadhi. So Lokanand means all the bliss that is present in the universe. Lok is a means universe or the world. The whole happiness of the whole world is equal to the bliss of the Samadhi. That is how I will interpret it. And that is true, isn't it? That is true. It is devoid of the impulses and it is devoid of any suffering. It is pure happiness. Just like he said, it is Samadhan, which means a completely content state. Nothing is needed and nothing is missing. Nothing can be added there. Shakti Sandhane Shariropatti. Shakti Sandhane Shariropatti. In the union of power is the origin of bodies. Let's see what this is saying. By infusing his energy of will, the embodiment of that which is willed occurs at once. So here again, it is pointing to a tantric practice. So Sandhan may mean application. That is another meaning which is not mentioned here. Actually, it is written here in bringing together. So Shakti Sandhan is the application of the energy which produces everything, including the bodies. You can give rise to anything. You can manifest anything using this energy. It is called the energy of will. There is no other energy actually. There is only one energy in the whole existence. That energy is the energy of will or energy of intention. The will moves everything and the will creates everything. It is the will of the Shiva, or you can say it is the will of the Shakti, not of the individual. The individual does not will. The individual is a puppet which acts on this divine will. If I want to do something, it is not me. This body mind is being used by the mother to do something. This is all of our... This is the direct experience of everyone. The I appears as the doer, or the takes the ownership of the action, which is only an appearance. It is an illusion. It facilitates this puppet. It adds a tack to the action that I did it. So taking the responsibility of an action is a tagging process. That is all. The mother keeps a record of who did what. You can say poetically. This tag is stamped on the memory every time an action happens. That I did it. This one did it. So because everything is happening because of the application of the energy. How to apply the energy? No, you cannot apply the energy. The energy applies you. Bhut sandhana bhut prathaktva vishwa sanghata. It's just one word here. It means union of elements, separatedness of elements, separateness of elements, and all pervading union. And as usual, in first look, nothing is clear. Let's say this one. By the greatness of this achievement of the energy of will, the yogi can focus his awareness and heal the sick and suffering, separate elements from his body and be free from the limitations of space and time. So again, I think it will be sufficient to say that it is possible to change the physical world, change things in the physical world using the energy of the will. It is said in Spanda, by taking hold of Spanda, the energy of will, even a feeble person becomes capable and fit to do whatever work he intends doing. The one who is filled with extreme and intense hunger can subside his hunger by focusing the force of the energy of will. And the absence of awareness robs your body of the wealth of spirituality. This absence of awareness is created by your own ignorance. If you wash off that ignorance existing in you with Spanda, the energy of will, then where does the possibility of the absence of awareness exist? And just as when an object is initially not clearly seen by ordinary people, and then when they put their attention on that object, they see it clearly and know what it is now and in any subsequent perception. So in the same way, wherever and whenever any object is existing, you have only to focus your energy of will there and you can perceive that object in an instant. So now you know why Shaivism is so popular and nobody likes Advaita, because Shaivism promises magic in this way. Shuddha Vidyodayash Chakresh Tattva Siddhihi. Fulfillment of being the Lord of the world is from arising of pure knowledge. And the pure knowledge rises, and by that knowledge he becomes the master of the universal wheel. So everybody knows by now what is the Shuddha Vidya. The pure knowledge. The greatest skill, Vidya, is knowledge. Chakresh is another name for the Lord of the Chakras. So here it is translated as the Lord of the world. And the Chakra is, everybody knows it is the wheel, circle. Ish is the Lord. And Siddhi is the accomplishment, achievement. So in my view, this sutra is saying that the pure knowledge, which is the knowledge of the self or the Shiv, with that knowledge, you acquire complete control over all the chakras. The chakras are energy centers in the body, and there are chakras everywhere. So anything that has a structure has a chakra. That means the energy flows in a specific way in that structure. So you get power over all these structures. This is the Siddhi that you achieve by learning this pure science of the Shiva. Vidya is also science. So as I said, the power does not mean that this human, this naked monkey gets the power. It is revealed that I always had that power. It is me who is doing everything, and I am doing it in a perfect way. That is the Siddhi, that is the realization. So those who are trying to get the powers by hook or crook, they achieve nothing. But those who realize their true nature get everything without doing anything. And yes, you can very well see that these teachings have been corrupted and twisted throughout the time to mean something else. And everybody is running after all kinds of miraculous powers. Maharudra Anusandhananam Mantra Virya Anubhava. From investigation of the great deep water is the experience of the energy of mantras. So as usual, nothing can be gained from this sentence here. We don't know the deep water, we don't know the energy of the mantras. And this book says, by the attentive continuity of the meditation on the great ocean of consciousness, the power of Supreme I is attained. So, Rid here may mean like sea or water, ocean. Maharid may mean that great ocean. Anusandhan means again observation or abiding. And Mantra Virya Anubhav means powerful experience of the mantras or potent experience of the mantras. That is what I could understand by this sutras. So here it says, all mantras live in and get life from that one mantra of the I consciousness. That's it in the Spandakarika. Actually, this book Spandakarika seems to be much better source. Everything makes sense there. So as we know, Virya is also the semen, the potent fluid. Mantra Virya may mean here the potency of the sound. And the sound is Spanda, obviously, not the sound that is uttered from the mouth. That is stupidity. The real mantra is the vibration that happens in the consciousness. Those vibrations were identified and given symbolic names and forms. Now it is lost, isn't it? Everybody is chanting something, hoping that it will give me powers and will do something. That is not Shiv Sutra's teaching. That is not Shiva's teaching or any of these great masters' teaching. Unfortunately, you have misunderstood. The mantra represents something in the mind. The mind is creation of the Shakti. She knows all the mantras. And you are lord of all the mantras because you are the Shakti. Can you become that by mechanically repeating some words that were identified as processes in the mind? Obviously, no. Anyway, I'm not trying to discourage anybody. Please keep doing your practices and hopefully you will achieve something. Hopefully you will get the powers, because it is only my own opinion. I never did any kind of a power struggle, never struggled to get the powers. So who knows? Yes, probably it is possible to do something or the other by hook or crook. You may get a little bit of Siddhi over this or that as a person, as a human animal, but realizing that I am the all-powerful one, I am the Viresh, I command all mantras already, and that is the biggest power that sets you free. Now there's no more running after petty powers. It is like you get the sweetest and mouth-watering fresh cake. Why would you run after dry rotten bread? If you have that cake, the hot and delicious cake of Shiva. So there ends the Shambho Pai. As you can imagine, not very popular. Does not feed the ego that much. So for those who could not understand anything at all in the first part, here is the second way. Second trick. The Shaktopai. Upai means a means, expedient. That by which one reaches one's aim. Shakti is translated as able, competent. But I don't think that is the correct translation. Shakti points to Shakti. The means of Shakti. The means of energies. Is the abilities and competencies the result of that. That is why they are called Shakti. Because they have utilized the Shakti and have become able. So the Shaiv tradition got divided into the Shaiv proper and the Shakti. Who are devoted to the mother. Not to the Shiv. Those who are devoted to the Shiv also are after Lingam and all those things. So with the fall of knowledge comes the fall of practices. So here is another photo of Swamiji, Swami Lakshmanju. This one is much clearer. In the second awakening of the Shiv Sutras, the author explains the second means of awakening called Shaktupai. The energy with which Shaktupai is concerned is not ordinary energy. This energy is the expansion. The commentary of Mantra Virya, the commentary of I consciousness. At the end of the first awakening, the author introduced Mantra Virya because he wanted the idea to be fully revealed and explained in the second awakening. To illuminate the actual state of Mantra Virya, the author first explains the reality of Mantra and then the power of Mantra Virya. So the very first sutra of the Shaktopaya says, Chittam Mantra. Mind is the mantra. Isn't it so obvious? The mind itself is a mantra. The mind itself is a vibration. Everything that is being done is being done by the mind. Every appearance is being created by the mind. The whole world and the bodies and whatever causal bodies and souls are creation of the mind. The chittam is a word for the bigger mind or the universal mind, as they call it. Not the human mind. The human mind is a tiny part of the chittam. Notice that the mantra comes from man, which means mind. And whenever there is tra in the end, it means a design or a utility or a technique. Tantra, yantra. And so is the mantra. So the word mantra itself gives away the secret that, look, the mantra is the mind. And this sutra is making it obvious. So it may not be translated as a sacred formula, because that sacred formula is only an external representation of what is happening in the mind. Simply repeating that formula does nothing. For example, you write down the formula that governs orbit of a rocket in the space and keep repeating that formula. Why? Because that governs the path of the rocket in the space. And keep hoping that probably by repeating this formula, a rocket will be launched in space. I'll achieve my objective. Something, some magical cause will launch the rocket because I'm repeating the formula. And you can see how stupid that is. You will need to do real work to launch a rocket. Yes, the rocket will follow the exact formula, exact laws that you have written down. But that does not mean that reciting the formula is going to do the work for you. It is impossible. So prayer does nothing. The songs do nothing. The secret formulas, they don't do anything. People keep chanting them for some reason. The mind is the mantra. The Sanskrit word chitta means the thought of a sacred word. This thought is said to be the exposition of mantra. Mantra therefore means sacred word. Sacred word is also the rise of the words and sentences in the internal mind of the aspirant. This is also mantra because this aspirant, like a sacred word, is absolutely purified inside and outside. So the aspirant's mind is mantra and the sacred word is also mantra. So I think this paragraph shows a little bit of insight that the interpreter has about what the mantra may mean. The word is, not the words of the language, the word is the vibration that resides in the mind. The mind is made up of vibrations. So the aspirant's mind is mantra and the sacred word is also mantra. So yes, you can get a little bit of hint that if you invite a certain kind of vibration, the mind changes, the perception changes, the body changes, the world changes. And it is not magic, it is everybody's experience. So he goes on and adds that here the word mind means that by which you become aware of supreme consciousness. So yes, it is an instrument, it reflects the consciousness only. So this mind is said to be that by which yourself is exposed in its fullness. Yes, that is also correct. Without the mind, there is no knowledge. Without the mind, there is nothing that reflects the consciousness. There is no way to know what I am and what consciousness is, and what the Shakti is. It is the creation of the mother. So you can see the utility of the mind here. The body is a part of the mind and the world is a part of the mind. And so their utility is to know the existence as consciousness and bliss. There is no other utility of these creations. So it goes on to add many things, just like any Shaiv tradition would do. And it gives examples of mantras. They are words. Just so let's see what Sarvajnanatra also explains. This is in the same way. Those mantras which are recited with the lips and with the mind are not really mantras. Devatas and Gandharva, all these great souls, have deluded themselves in thinking that these are actual mantras. And additionally, they are filled with tremendous pride, thinking that they are verbally reciting the name of God. So you see, the ancient people had the sense. The modern people have lost it. And not only Devatas and Gandharvas, which are evolved forms of humans, not only they, the humans also delude themselves in thinking that whatever is being recited with the lips, the noises they are making, very strange noises, are mantras. It is not a mantra. Fortunately, we have the Shaktopaya, so you know now what is mantra. those so-called mantras are not actually mantras. Mantra is divinity in the mind of the yogi, or the flow of subjective God consciousness towards objective God consciousness, or the simultaneous flow of subjective God consciousness towards objective God consciousness, and the flow of objective God consciousness towards subjective God consciousness. I don't think anybody will understand these things right now, but that is not important. All you need to know is what is not mantra. That is most important. And in this age, it is totally in ruins, this whole technology of the mantra. And the real reason is misunderstanding of what is written in the text like this. So Tantra Sadbhav Me says this same thing. The life of all mantras is solely the energy of God consciousness. When that energy is absent, all those collections of words are useless, just like a mass of clouds in the rainless autumn sky. So that's what I was talking about. You write it down, you say it, you do the japa a million times, it is useless. The formula in the book is not going to launch your rocket in space. This should be common sense. Somehow it is absent. In Shrikanti Samhita Shastra, it is also said, the one who recites mantra for the sake of realizing God will never attain the reality of God consciousness. There is only one thing that a yogi must maintain, and that is awareness. Awareness of union of objective God consciousness with subjective God consciousness. And in one driving push, the flow of objective and subjective God consciousness. So, the scripture itself is telling, don't do that. And what do people do? They do exactly that. You will never see these things called gods or goddesses or Shakti or Shiv by reciting a mantra. And when we say this without invoking the scripture, obviously it makes the person very mad, because it is an assault on his belief system. The belief system that he has gathered from somewhere, somebody told him, and then he now owns it as my own property. So that makes them mad. If you try to teach such a person, he's going to cut your throat. So it should not be said in person to somebody who is chanting mantras all day and night in front of the idols and whatever. In Spanda, because these words are digested along with the mind of the aspirant, they are said to be along with the divinity of the yogi, one with divine God consciousness. So yes, the person needs to rise to that level in order to see the mantra, in order to observe how it works, how the Shakti works, how the Shakti is flowing through this instrument of the body and mind, what it is accomplishing, and all that. It is a mental activity. The mantra is not a ritual. So that is very important, I think. Important point has been made. Prayatna sadhaka. Persevering effort is fulfilling. So prayatna means effort. Sadhaka means the seeker. Pauseless effort brings about his attainment of God consciousness. So according to me, this simply means that for the one who is following the Shaktopai, there is no other way except effort. Pauseless effort. Relentless seeking. It is a formula now. It is a sutra. The word sutra means formula. Those who do not want to do the effort, they should try the Shambhavopai first. Get the direct path. Those who do not want to go there because it's not that fanciful will need to do effort. Vidya Sharira Satya. Vidya Sharira Satta Mantra Rahasyam. The being of the body of knowledge is the secret of a mantra. No, I don't understand what is this. He says the secret essence of a mantra is establishment in the body of the knowledge of oneness. So probably this is much better. But after some thinking, I think that the word Satta means existence and being. Yes, the true existence and being. And embodying that existence is the secret of a mantra. Becoming that existence gives you a power over the mantra. Become the whole. Become the Shiv. And all mantras are yours. And even if you don't know that you are Shiv, the mantras are doing whatever they do. The effectiveness of mantra is why the Maya, why the Mother, the Uma, the Shakti. So this is also quoted in Sri Tantra Sadbhava Tantra. All letters are actually one with mantra, and all those mantras are one with Mother. the energy of Lord Shiva, and that mother is one with Lord Shiva himself. So those who have listened to the whole of the Shambhavopaya know what this means. It is very clear. The language itself is a product of mantra. People think that mantras are written in language. No, the language is written in mantras. The whole of the Sanskrit language and all the ancient languages, they were created as divine symbols. You cannot write a mantra in language. It is the mind, you see. Whatever appears as language and symbols is a result of execution of a mantra which happens in the mind. We already have this siddhi. You must have noticed that a human being can form words, sentences that are meaningful and can speak. This power is absent in animals. The only motion they are capable of is emotion. When the body responds to the emotions in the mind of an animal, we can sense that they are trying to say something. Although I do not claim to know everything about animals, but there are some very smart ones who look like it seems that they are thinking, just like we do. But that can be an illusion. We have this power, which is very, very clear. So that is why now you can relate the two meanings of the word matrika. The matrika means mother, and the matrika also means the letter. It is so beautiful that this word was chosen for the letters of language, the alphabet, because the alphabet comes from the mother. The whole alphabets, I don't know about the modern languages, but the old languages, the Hebrew, the Sanskrit, the Greek, these letters were constructed out of mantras. Of course, the biggest of the mantra is the Om, about which we did a very detailed study in the reading of Mandukya Karika. The whole Mandukya Upanishad is about Om, nothing else. So yes, there can be a little bit of misinterpretation here and there, but I think the essence is very, very clear. Probably we may not get the total word-to-word and letter-by-letter meaning of all the sutras. Probably it is lost already, but we can get a little bit of essence. We get a broad idea of what this Shiva Sutra is saying. Garbhe chitta vikaso vishishta vidya swapna. Development of the mind in the womb is the dream of indistinct knowledge. When a yogi's mind is satisfied with the expensive body of illusion, then he falls in the world of differentiated perceptions, and his knowledge of being is just like that of ordinary living beings. So here the Sanskrit word garbhe means that expensive body of the energy of illusion. That is Mahamaya, the great illusive energy of Lord Shiva. The body of illusion that is being referred to are the limited yogic powers, that is, creating divine incense or the materialization of sacred ash, walking on water, flying in air, etc., etc. All these powers are existing in the sphere of Maya. When the yogi exhibits the world of limited powers and his mind becomes satisfied and does not move ahead, then for him, this knowledge of being is like the world of dreams. It is not knowledge at all. His knowledge is just the same as the knowledge held by ordinary worldly people. And so, like ordinary living beings, he falls and is established in the world of differentiation with various perceptions and thoughts. This is also said in Patanjali's Yoga Darshan. Those lights in the center of the eyebrow and divine sounds in the center of heart are obstacles for samadhi. And the experiences that come in front of this yogi are called samadhu upsarga, obstacles to attaining real samadhi. These are obstacles for that yogi. For worldly men, on the other hand, they appear as great powers and they appreciate these powers. They say the yogi who possesses these powers is a real person, a real yogi. They applaud him, saying that he bestows these powers on his devotees. This is narrated in Spanda Karika in this verse. As soon as Spanda is meditated upon, the yogi perceives some divine light emanating between the eyebrows. He hears divine sounds resonating in the heart, divine form appears in his sight, and divine taste is experienced on his tongue. These are all just disturbances in the state of real being and are to be avoided by those yogis who wish to become fortunate. So you can read all these things, but clearly the text is saying that it is possible to fall for a yogi, and the manifestations of these useless powers becomes a great obstacle for his spiritual progress. That is what you need to take home. Although word-to-word interpretation of this sutra will be fruitless, I think. The development of the mind in the womb is a dream of existing knowledge. It's kind of very difficult now to... So everybody knows what is garbh. It is the womb. Chitta vikaso is progress of the mind. Avishishta vidya is indistinct knowledge. Swapna means dream. So what can you make of it? So essentially it is saying that the illusion, the garbh has been translated as the illusion, the womb of the maya, it is possible to fall into it in a dreamlike state, just like any ordinary person is, and stop our progress because we assume that I have the powers or I know something which ordinary people don't know. So although this sentence is totally devoid of meaning, something can be gathered from this very difficult sutra here. I am not sure what is the correct interpretation. Vidya samutthane svabhavike khechri shivavastha. Flying, the state of Shiva, is in the rising of knowledge arising from one's own nature. So khechri is translated as the flying or moving in air. Vidya is knowledge, utthan is rising. Svabhav is nature, khechri is flying. Shivavastha is the state of being the Shiv, being the consciousness. Probably it is clear, but let's find out. The pure knowledge of God consciousness effortlessly rises, and this state of Shiva is realized as one with the state of Khechri. And this book says that this Khechri is not the Khechri described in these two verses. When the yogi is seated in Padmasana, he must put his mind, the master of all organs, in the center of the navel. He must sit erect until the time when the three ethers or voids, Shakti, Vyapini and Saman, come into existence for him. Then immediately this yogi should infuse the supreme void by taking hold of these three voids. By practicing in this way, this yogi enters the mudra of Khechri. This state described above is not real Khechri mudra. It should be avoided. What is real Khechri mudra? When you are treading the way of totality, you must see the totality in a piece of the totality. Take one part of the universe and see the whole universe existing there. That is the way of totality. So just as it is said in the Tantra Sadbhav, the Khechri Mudra is becoming one with Supreme Consciousness. So there can be a lot of debate about what is Khechri. So here it is translated as the flying, the state of Shiva, this stance of flying through the void of Supreme Consciousness, as said by Abhinav Gupta. So we can take a hint from here that the Khechri is not real flying. The body does not fly in Khechri. The mind may fly. And that happens when the mind is established in the state of pure consciousness. It's turned inwards. And that can be done by specific practices, by holding the energy of the mind in a specific way, which only an experienced guru can teach you. So after looking at this sutra for a while, it appears that it is saying that the natural progress of this knowledge, the free state or the Khechri state is attained, which is nothing but abiding in the Shiva nature, in the true nature. So by the way, the Khechri means walking in the void. The word kha, whenever it occurs, mostly stands for void, vacuum, space. Char is going. So Khechri is going in space. So if you are feeling helpless, like what do these things mean actually? Then go to the roots of the words, because the words were not chosen willy-nilly. They were chosen very carefully. And just like Khechri, and the meaning itself of Khechri gives you an idea of the state of the mind that yogi is having when he's practicing Khechri. He is going in the space, into the shunyata, into the emptiness, which is nothing but pure consciousness. And this is possible by restraining the mind. By restraining the mind, one means redirecting the energies of the mind that are flowing here and there, animating the body and so on. Like he mentioned, a few of these vayus or the winds, you can get hold of them, and then the mind turns inwards and abides in the true nature, which is Shiv Avastha. And this state is called going in space, space of your true nature, abiding in this infinite space, which has no qualities, which is empty except of consciousness. So probably this gives us a little bit of guidance here. What does the Shaktopaya involve? It involves the effort, but the goal is the same. Number 6, Guru Rupai. The Guru is the means, which everybody will agree. Those who are on the Shaktopaya abandon all hopes of progress without a Guru. Shivopaya is easy. Without a Guru, it's possible. You only need your intellect. A very sharp and trained intellect. But the path of effort demands guidance. Even if you are looking for some easy and quick powers or siddhi over mantras and all, you will need a guru, the one who has already done that. So guru is the one who dispels darkness. Without knowledge, no achievement. So it is a requirement in the on the path of effort here. Even if it is not kundalini, not shakti, even if it is yoga or something like that, or something very, very worldly that you want to earn money or something, guidance is needed. You need to follow somebody who has already done that. Self-knowledge is very natural. Everybody has the potential of this knowledge. Matrika Chakra Sambodh. Perfect knowledge of the multitude of letters. And by that, probably he means that through this kind of upai, one achieves a knowledge of the Matrika Chakra, which is the mother, the Shakti. Matrika Chakra is the activity of the Shakti. So number 7 here says, the disciple attains the knowledge of the wheel of hidden mother. So if you remove the extra words here, it is the meaning is very clear. So there is a lot of esoteric explanation here in esoteric words, but you get the essence of it. This teaching is also given in the spanda of this verse. This energy of action of Lord Shiva entangles Lord Shiva in the individual state of life. And when Lord Shiva realizes the nature of his nature of this energy, of his own self, then it will cease to entangle him. It entangles only when it is not realized. Once it is realized, you are freed from all the bondages of life. And here ends the theory of Matrika. So the book has actually many pages devoted to the what is Matrika really and what is Kundalini and all that. So those who are interested may read this whole of it. We are only interested right now in knowing the meaning of this sutra, which it says that with the effort, perseverance, with the guru and so on, you will get the perfect knowledge of the activity of the mother. The Shakti will be known to you, and that is liberating. Now the Shakti will no longer control you. Shariram Havi. The body is an oblation. And probably that means that the body is an instrument. When you do the rituals, you offer things into the fire. So obviously it does not mean do not offer your body into the fire. It means it is like an oblation that you are offering. The seeker is now much more than a body, and his activities are much more than simply looking after the body and feeding the body and keeping the body healthy and so on. He is no longer a slave of the body. He is using the body for something more. So a seeker needs to offer his body into the practices, the fire of practices. The establishment of I consciousness on the body becomes an offering in the fire of God consciousness. Same thing said in a more fancy way here. Dhyanam annam. Knowledge is food. For such a seeker, knowledge is his primary goal, not the food or comforts of the life. A seeker is always hungry for knowledge. Vidyasanhare, tadutya swapna pradarshanam. Vidyasanhare, tadutya swapna darshanam. In the destruction of the knowledge is the appearance of dreaming, of a coming forth of that. So, vidyasanhar means the destruction of knowledge. Tadutya means thus arising. Swapna is the dream, darshanam is the appearance. So although he is established in God consciousness in samadhi, yet not being able to maintain awareness, after a short time he enters into the dreaming state. So this makes it clear actually. that when the knowledge is destroyed, when the abiding is lost, the seeker is lost in the dream appearances. So a very big goal, for very important goal for such a seeker, is maintenance of awareness 24/7. The awareness must be maintained. And since this is the last sutra for Shaktopai, you can see that it is probably very important. So this book also says that this losing awareness is the great crisis in the yogic world. All yogis generally experience this state of losing awareness. And when they do, they go to the dreaming state, because that state is subtler than the waking state. In the world of experience and awareness, the grossest state is the waking state. A more subtle state is the dreaming state, and more subtle still is soundless sleep. And the most subtle is samadhi. So it is very difficult to maintain awareness as samadhi. There is only one way you can maintain awareness in samadhi, and that is when your master is exceedingly pleased with you. When he is pleased with you, you will be able to maintain awareness. Otherwise, it is impossible. So I don't want to discourage people by saying that go and please your master. First, probably he wants to say here that if your master is pleased, your awareness practice is going very well. Nothing else can please the master. Not money, not feet-licking behavior, and not worshipping master as a god of some kind. These things irritate the master. When you are in complete awareness all the time, this pleases the master. So there are, all the states are mentioned here, the gross and the subtle and all. You need to keep your awareness on. It takes effort. It takes practice. And not very surprisingly, this is the only practice on the Advait path also. On the path of knowledge, there is only one practice, and that is to maintain your awareness, which means maintaining the knowledge of who you are. As soon as you lose this knowledge, as soon as you lose yourself in the world, in the illusion, in the dream, disasters happen. It is a step backward for a seeker. So first get the theoretical knowledge, get the experiential knowledge, do the practices and all of different chakras and yogas and kundalini and whatever. You, if you have not pleased your master like this by maintaining the awareness, you are not progressing. It is further stated in the Malini Vijaya Tantra. The yogi who does not maintain awareness at the time he achieves supreme yogic powers becomes detached from the awareness of God consciousness. This yogi has diminished his power of moving forward, and the obstacles of life toy with him. So what can be bigger disasters? You are trying to achieve a mastery over the life and energies and whatnot, and just losing your awareness makes you ordinary. This is a failure for a yogi. Spandakarika says the creative energy of Lord Shiva, becoming independent of that yogi who is lacking awareness, plays with him who now acts and experiences wakefulness and the dreaming state just like ordinary people. This yogi lacks awareness. He does not maintain the full awareness of God consciousness. Because of this, the creative energy of Lord Shiva, previously contingent on his maintaining awareness, becomes independent of him. This creative energy plays with him just like she does with ordinary people. In wakefulness, he does what worldly people do, and in the dreaming state, he experiences what they experience. Now, there is no difference between this yogi and a common person. This is said in the Malini Vijaya Tantra. Do not become attached to yogic powers. Be detached from them. So people who get a little bit of control over their body, mind, whatever, they think that, oh, I'm done here. My life goal has been achieved. And they proceed to act on their powers. That is a recipe for disaster again, because as soon as you proceed to act, you become a toy of the mother. The Shakti starts controlling you, because the action produces consequences, and the consequences then impress on your mind. You become the receiver of the consequences, and that ensures that in the Maya or Shakti, goddess or mother, has complete control over you now. You are in her cage now. You let her go, so she is controlling you now. So losing the awareness is a bigger loss than losing the powers or any other achievements, worldly achievements, spiritual achievements. They are petty compared to the awareness. So one more good point here for the Shaktipai. The object of meditation is not differentiated perception. It is an object of your own nature, which you meditate on with thought. This meditation is not accomplished through the recitation of mantra. It is only accomplished with thought. You must maintain awareness of that object. This is the way of Shaktipaya. So there are some yogis who are treading on the path of Shaktipaya who are unable to maintain awareness. For them, this last sutra has been explained. This is a very, very, very important thing, actually. The destruction of knowledge brings you back into the dream. And here ends the second awakening or the Shaktipaya. And we will continue reading the Shiva Sutras and go through the third way, the fine way or Anvopai, in the coming part of this series. Thank you very much for listening.